Hi all, Jessica here and welcome to Critic. In this video, we'll go through not only the workup, but we'll focus a bit more on the treatment of hyperkalemia. Let's go, shall we? There are a couple of statements I made in previous videos on potassium that are helpful in remembering the workup to hyperkalemia. First, potassium resides predominantly inside of our cells. Second, our kidneys are great at retaining sodium and excreting potassium, so it's pretty rare to have hyperkalemia with normal renal function, but it does happen. And third, potassium shifts over the cellular membrane. Let's go through these quickly. The extracellular potassium, the one you measure in serum, is around 4.5 millimoles per liter, while the intracellular concentration is 30-fold, being around 150 millimoles per liter. So cracking open a cell like an egg will spill potassium and result in hyperkalemia. This is the case in hemolysis, rhabdomyolysis, excessive burns, tumor lysis syndrome, and crush trauma. If our kidneys are great at excreting potassium, it goes without saying that renal failure can result in hyperkalemia. If GFR falls, less potassium will be presented in urine. Potassium excretion is furthermore governed by the mineral corticoid action of aldosterone and by tubular secretion. So a defect in either of these systems will cause hyperkalemia. Examples of aldosterone deficiency are drug-related, like ACE inhibitors, ARBs, and potassium-sparing diuretics like spironolactone, or an adrenal crisis, Addison's. Examples of impaired tubular secretion are some forms of renal tubular acidosis. If you've seen my video on hypokalemia, you know that potassium is prone to transcellular shifts. Flip the causes and you'll get the ones that result in hyperkalemia. Acidosis, hyperthermia, note that I've never seen it in fever, and beta blockers. Now let's briefly touch upon pseudohyperkalemia. Just like in pseudohyponatremia, this is an erroneous measurement, so you're not to be worried about possible complications from hyperkalemia. The most common cause is prolonged tourniquet use while getting a venous sample. The tourniquet crushes the red blood cells that get into your sample. So the measurement is correct, high potassium, but it's only in your sample and not in the entire body. If you're unsure if this is the cause, get a new sample. Still unsure? Get an arterial sample. Pseudohyperkalemia is also seen in severe thrombocytosis and leukocytosis as they cause in vitro release of potassium from inside of the cells. If your patient has hyperkalemia above 6.0, your immediate action is to monitor your patient and get an ECG stat, as hyperkalemia can cause heart blocks and ventricular fibrillation. Symptoms of hyperkalemia are not really specific, but include tingling sensations, muscle weakness, and paralysis. Symptoms or ECG abnormalities call for immediate cardiac monitoring, so admit to a cardiac or medium care, and immediate treatment, the first of which is the administration of calcium. The following steps of treatment should be on your mind. First, calcium. Calcium doesn't lower serum potassium levels, but it stabilizes the cellular membrane of the heart, decreasing excitability and thus decreasing the chance of cardiac arrest. It should be given to symptomatic patients, especially patients with ECG abnormalities like QRS widening or when the CT segment resembles a sign pattern. It should not be given to patients that use digoxin because it can lead to digitalis intoxication, or in combination with bicarbonate as it may form depositions. So what do you do? When in doubt and to prevent delay, just administer calcium, as there is very little harm. Give 10 cc's of calcium gluconate 10%. This buys you about 30 minutes. If your patient is unstable, use calcium chloride, as this is more potent and can be administered faster, but it can cause severe thrombophlebitis. Second, insulin glucose solution. Remember that insulin causes a transcellular shift of potassium towards intracellular, so it's only a temporary solution. The glucose is added to prevent hypoglycemia. Typical dose is 10 units of insulin, the rapid kind like ActoRapid or NovoRapid, combined with 50 cc's of 50% glucose. The onset of effect is around 20 to 30 minutes, and it will lower potassium with about 1 millimole per liter. Reduce the dose of insulin in patients with renal failure. Try 6. This step will buy you around 4 to 6 hours. So what do? Give it to all patients that are symptomatic or have ECG changes. If your patient is asymptomatic and without ECG abnormalities, give it if hyperkalemia is above 6.0 and you can't remove the cause within a few hours. Just like with calcium, there's not much you can do wrong in this case. Third, potassium binders, like sodium polystyrene sulfonate, rosonium, or calcium polystyrene sulfonate, sorbisterite. These are insoluble molecules that bind potassium in the large intestine, preventing them from being absorbed. The effect starts after 2 to 4 hours and lasts for several hours, so it won't help you in the acute setting, but it's still considered very important and may be repeated. So what do? Always give a potassium binder. Just realize it's not the first step in treatment. I prefer a calcium preparation over the sodium one. This is because, as mentioned before, a lot of patients with hyperkalemia have impaired renal function, and administration of sodium could cause renal fluid overload. With the calcium preparation, just be careful with digoxin and with sodium bicarbonate. Fourth, salbutamol. Nebulizing with salbutamol causes a transcellular shift. Again, it's a temporary fix and should only be used if above measures aren't sufficient. Don't nebulize unstable patients with cardiac arrhythmias, as salbutamol causes beta stimulation and thus tachycardia. The effect on potassium is immediate and lasts for about 2 to 4 hours. Consider the following treatments for specific conditions: dialysis in renal failure, diuretics in fluid overload in patients that still have urinary production, sodium bicarb for acidosis. Give 100 cc's of 8.4% solution and repeat if necessary. Give hydrocortisone for adrenal insufficiency, 100 mg intravenously. All steps should be considered for every patient with hyperkalemia, but for asymptomatic patients without ECG changes, we usually start with the insulin glucose solution, followed by a dietary restriction combined with potassium binders, and we treat the underlying cause. To sum this up, remember that in hyperkalemia, your first actions should be to check for symptoms and get an ECG stat. If they're good, you've bought yourself some time to think about the cause. Remember that in people with normal renal function, the most common cause is pseudohyperkalemia, which doesn't require treatment. Repeat the analysis, preferably in a blood gas sample, because that will also help you with the workup. Measure serum creatinine levels for estimated GFR. For treatment, when in doubt or when delayed, sometimes ECGs can take forever, remember that there is little harm in administering calcium, though it is contraindicated in patients with digoxin. There is little harm in administering insulin glucose solution, though be careful in patients with renal failure. And there is little harm in giving a potassium binder. That's all! Drop me a line in the comments with your thoughts. Thanks for watching, and don't forget to subscribe if you haven't already.